Okay, so we are going to finish up today talking about euthanasia and assisted suicide, and then we're going to work our way into environmental issues and global justice issues. And as I think you were aware last time, there's there's a lot of material that I like to talk with you about, and we're not going to be able to do all of it, and so we'll kind of work our way through it. And you're welcome to raise your hand and stop me at any time, and we can debate and discuss. So, and then a couple of you were there at the talk last night, so we're going to return towards the end. We're going to just tell you what she said, basically, in case you weren't able to make it yesterday. I thought it was quite an extraordinary talk, and we're very privileged in Fresno to have her. She's, you know, she just delivered this report to the United Nations a couple days ago, and so she was here sharing that with us, Hillel Elver. Real quick, I'm not going to go into this in any kind of detail, but the Ethics Center here at Fresno State, I do a lot of workshops and training on professional ethics and ethical issues. And one of the things I bring with me is what I've created, this framework for ethical decision making. And I kind of lifted this and compiled it from a variety of sources. One great source is the Santa Clara Ethics Center, the Ethics Center at Santa Clara called the Mercula Center. And they have a whole website devoted to this kind of stuff. But basically what I suggest, you know, in terms of making ethical decisions, sort of six steps. The first is make sure we understand the facts and understand the difference between facts and values. So we talked about that last time, the problem of going from an is to an ought. And sometimes we make ethical mistakes because we don't have the facts right, right? So it's important to get the facts right. The second thing that we want to talk about is who has the responsibility to do something? Actually, one of the big problems in the world is a lot of people butt their noses in when they don't need to. And then some people butt their noses out when they actually should butt in, right? So there's an interesting question about professional responsibilities. And that goes, you know, back to issues of negligence and due diligence and so on. So, you know, it's kind of difficult to figure out who has to do what with regard to an ethical decision, especially within an organization that involves hierarchies and so on. Then we often get confused about the kind of judgments we are making. And sometimes it's not really an ethical issue. It's just a matter of taste or preference or manners. And there's kind of a continuum there from etiquette to ethics. And there is, you know, it requires a bit of careful thinking to figure out what's the difference between just bad manners and actual ethical problems. So we have to clarify how we're making judgments and what matters. There's another interesting difference, which is between legal issues and moral issues. So sometimes, you know, you're just required to follow the rules, even if the rules are unethical? Okay, so now it gets interesting, because then there may be civil disobedience and, you know, all kinds of subterfuge you can do to the kind of malingering, you know, attempt to sort of slow things down by not complying and so on. Anyway, that itself is complicated. And then this is just sort of to review with you what we kind of talked a little bit about last time, is that there are different normative theories which provide us with frameworks for thinking about what matters, thinking about what's right or what's wrong, what's good and what's evil. And real quickly, I want to go through this because we're then going to apply these today. So one is a natural law approach, which says that there's a structure in the world. And if we use reason, we can see that structure and understand what our obligations are in terms of ethics. Natural rights language shows up here, right? When the Declaration of Independence says we're endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among those are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That's a declaration of natural law, okay, what are sort of written into the world of nature. A different approach thinks about models and virtues, role models, and sort of what they embody. And in this tradition, in the virtue ethics approach, we use adjectives like honest, courageous, or, you know, on the vice side, dishonest, cowardly, and so on, okay? Slightly different from the natural law account, because if you think about the Declaration of Independence, nowhere does it say, you should be courageous, right? So the utilitarian approach focuses on producing the greatest happiness for the greatest number.
Excuse me.
Help yourself. Focuses on producing good consequences for people. do you see that that's actually different from this approach, which says that there are fundamental rights? Sometimes defending your rights doesn't make anyone happy, right? So between those two, there's a question about what matters, whether our happiness matters, as the utilitarian will suggest, or whether our rights matter. A more technical approach associated with this philosopher, Immanuel Kant, asks us basically to universalize our principles. And if we could say that everyone should behave this way without creating a contradiction, then that is the moral thing to do. That's the Kantian deontological approach. Can it be universalized? Sort of like what your mother said, you know, how would you like it if everyone did that? But a little bit more complicated philosophically, okay. Then there's the social contract approach, which is about what we agree to, right? Contracts work that way, right? We make promises to one another. And this can happen even at the level of society where we reciprocate, right? So I follow the rules because you follow the rules, and in the long run, we all get along better, all right? The last one is relatively new development associated, comes out of feminist critique of all this other stuff, actually. And some feminists, Nell Noddings is the most famous one, she was a professor at Stanford. Some feminists argue that what really matters is care and nurture and the kind of human relationships that individuals have. Notice with this one, sometimes, think about it from the standpoint of a mother or a father, would you ever give the benefit of the doubt to your offspring, even if that meant violating someone else's rights, even if that meant maybe doing something that was either courageous or, cowardly or dishonest, that might violate the greatest happiness of the greatest number, and so on. Right? On this approach, maybe there's something about our relationships that really matters, our loving relationships. Okay, so these all are varieties of normative theory, and they can be applied in lots of different ways. And when you start realizing how complicated this is why you need big fat books, 500-page long book like I wrote for this, because you can apply each of these within each context, making sure, back over here, that we got the facts right, that we understand who has to do what, that we clarify what kind of judgments we're working through. We understand the legal framework, the religious background, the cultural ideas. It's difficult. Okay. I'm going to skip this one because it's just going to get too complicated. But let's go to this last point, which is when making ethical decisions, we should admit that we often screw it up. Now, you may be aware of this, that often the cover-up is worse than the crime problem, right? One issue in ethical decision-making, especially in organizations and, you know, I mean, stuff that rises to the level of public concern, is people fail to apologize. People fail to ask for help. People fail to admit their own failures. And then that results in ongoing moral catastrophe and collapse, right? This one is often the thing that people forget to do ever, right? To ask around for advice, to be willing to revise, to be willing to admit that you made a mistake, because after all, we're all fallible, right? No one's perfect. Okay, so anyway, if you're interested in this ethical decision-making framework kind of stuff, you can go to the Ethics Center website at Santa Clara University. All right, let's skip over that. So we're going to return back to euthanasia and assisted suicide discussion. Any questions about that moral framework decision-making stuff? I mean, we could talk about that for an hour and a half, but let's move into applied topic. One of the things that happens when we're talking about euthanasia, and someone asked me this after class or sent me an email and said, you know, that stuff's really complicated and I went way too fast on it last time. So my apologies. Let's slow down for a minute. In the philosophical discussions of this stuff, we want to make distinctions of varieties of end-of-life killing. Now, the word euthanasia literally is translated as good death, to die well. The EU prefix in Greek, EU means good, like in the word euphoria, right, which is good experience or good feeling. Like in the word eugenics, which is good genes, which means killing off the bad genes, which is morally controversial, to say the least. So within the conversation about euthanasia, we make a distinction between passive and active. Passive is allowing someone to die by withholding or withdrawing care, right? active is actually killing someone by some kind of active intervention. In the United States, varieties of passive euthanasia are legally permitted. So you're probably aware of this. It is perfectly legitimate to pull the plug on someone, I mean, given some other, you know, moral constraints and frameworks and so on. But you can pull the plug or refuse care, which is the withholding care issue. This is not permitted, active euthanasia. It's some European countries, there is some permission towards active euthanasia. The Netherlands tends to be fairly permissive about this stuff. You can see the difference, right? Passive euthanasia, we often call that letting nature take its course, right? So it's not the failure to treat that kills the patient, it's the underlying disease, right? The disease is the thing that produces death, letting nature take its course.
Withholding nutrition.
Yeah, withholding hydration and nutrition and all of that stuff. Now, interesting moral argument, withholding hydration. For example, what I learned in the Boy Scouts was what, like this rule of threes, 3 minutes without air, 3 days without water, and 3 weeks without food or something like that. Like, I mean, it was Boy Scouts. I don't quite, you know, I'm sure it's more complicated than that. But one of the things people will say about passive euthanasia is that it's actually kind of cruel to withhold hydration or food or whatever. And it may seem more humane to actively kill the person. Now, that's we could talk about this for a couple weeks. Interesting question, right? Is it ever legitimate to actively bring about someone's death? Some will say never, ever legitimate. And the legal framework sort of recognizes that moral intuition. And yet we may end up in some cases where we prolong suffering in order to avoid making that difficult moral choice. Right? So philosophers have debated this in many ways. Any thoughts about active and passive? Yeah.
If someone is dying in very severe pain and you start to push morphine and you keep pushing it till the pain goes away, but you give so much morphine you kill them, the intent was not to kill them. The intent was to treat the pain.
Yes. Yeah, so now this is a nice moral distinction about intention, okay? So notice already we're in this moral framework question, normative theories show up here. Maybe what matters is our intention. That's the only thing that matters. Maybe I'm intending to help the person. Even when I hold the pillow over their face, I'm intending to help them, maybe, right? If intention is the only thing that matters, and that fits with what's called the deontological view, the Kant's view that focuses on intentions, maybe in that case, the distinction between passive and active doesn't really matter much because the moral judgment traces back to the intention behind it, right? A different view sets intention aside and focuses on consequences, right? Maybe what really matters is the amount of suffering there is. And by the way, that may expand to include lots of different people, including caregivers and family members and so on, right? What you're talking about is sometimes called terminal sedation, right? Where sort of there's this, we sort of can predict that it's going to lower respiration and so on, and that the person is going to die quicker or something. But there's a little kind of moral magic that happens here when we back into talking about intentions. There's a thing called the doctrine of double effect. Those of you who know anything about the Catholic tradition, actually people talk about this also, which would say, the doctrine of double effect would say, that it is permissible to do one thing that's moral, knowing that there may be a secondary effect that could happen as long as the secondary effect is not intended primarily, right? Gets complicated there. Some people will say, that's just moral nonsense. And then others find that quite persuasive. So you're right. I mean, this is an interesting question. Yes?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, the big reason is I'm a hospice nurse, so no qualifications. Two things. One is there have been a lot of studies that have shown that when a person's pain is controlled with morphine or other medications, they actually can live longer than they were expected to live without that, because the body uses so much energy to fight the pain.
Yeah.
And the other thing I would be remiss not to mention is if a person is in the active dying process, very close to the end of life, their systems are shutting down, they have no ability to process food or fluid, then you are possibly doing more harm and putting them in more pain than by feeding them, because it's just going to sit either in their esophagus or in their stomach and not go on through. So it, even between passive and active, there are circumstances that you would not want to give somebody at that point in life food or drink, unless you were knowingly willing to make them less comfortable.
Did everyone hear this? You guys heard that? Yeah. So notice, I mean, one thing from the moral standpoint is we got to get all the facts out, right? So we need to understand the complexity of the dying process. And a lot of people will argue with all of this stuff that, you know, the solution is not to start talking about how to kill people. The solution is to talk about better caregiving through the end of life, right? So palliative care and hospice and the rest of it. There's a worry that you know, sort of, you know, especially people who were arguing this about physician-assisted suicide, you know, the minute we start talking about, well, we're just going to end life, that there's this slippery slope towards giving up on all of this productive stuff that we can do to make people's dying more comfortable, right? The moral questions are made even more complicated by all the technical details, right? So now each judgment is sort of situational based on what kind of disease we're talking about and the prognosis and so on. When set that aside. There's more to be said, but let's keep moving, okay? The difference between voluntary, involuntary, and non-voluntary. So voluntary is when someone asks for it to happen, right? When there is consent, right? You could imagine some circumstances where people would say, please let me die, or in some strange circumstances, please actively kill me, right? So the voluntary, involuntary issue can track back in more than one way on the previous two, right? So now we got at least two things at play and four possibilities, okay? Voluntary is when there is consent. Involuntary is when there is no consent. And frankly, when there's no consent, we call that murder. usually. So, I mean, it's very rare that you hear anyone talking about involuntary euthanasia. And one side note here, you should know about the word euthanasia, is that the Nazis used the word too. Right? We're going to put people to sleep and take them out of their misery because they're not worthy to live. So there's a risk. I mean, some people have been even nervous about, you know, bringing this language back in. Non-voluntary is when we don't know. So if someone suddenly has a brain injury and we never had the conversation with them and we don't know what their wishes would have been one way or another, this was sort of the problem with Terry Schiavo. Actually, with Terry Schiavo, it was more complicated because the two parties thought that there were different wishes, right? They thought that that Terry had different interests. But nobody actually had the definitive claim about what her interests were. And so, you know, there was that long, drawn-out case that made it to the U.S. Congress, if I remember that. So one of the things, you know, I talk with students about this is you want to try to avoid this by having those conversations, right? And you may know about, you know, living wills and durable power of attorney and all the rest of that stuff to put our wishes down so that people know. So we're not in that kind of stuck position where we're not exactly sure what the person would want. Yeah.
Okay. I tell my family I don't want to live as a vegetable. If I'm in an accident, I want to die. I put it in writing, a DNR or whatever the term is. I get into an accident, I'm a vegetable. They don't give me food, they don't give me water, they pull all the plugs, I live.
Then what? Well, I mean, one of the...
Does that make it active if they push me over the edge?
It would. I mean, morally, right? The difference... It's actually very complicated. What is it to not do? Is not doing something also doing something? Right? I mean, so some ethicists will say there's not much difference between the two because always you're doing something, right? And yet we sort of intuitively know what the difference is to, you know, withhold care, withhold food, whatever, versus holding the pillow over someone or injecting them with something. We sort of see that's pretty clear difference. The other part you're talking about is you had one set of wishes, you put it in writing, you communicate it, and then the circumstances turn out differently, right? One difficulty, of course, you can't predict every outcome, right? Moreover, some of the literature on this, in the case of, massive brain trauma and so on, that's a little, I would guess, in a sense, more obvious, right? But there is a problem in predicting our own future interests. And so some of the people that are worried about euthanasia will point out that actually our own understanding of our own well-being and interests changes over time and through the course of illness, right? So you may say, I would never want to live like that. And when you get to that, you're like, oh, this isn't as bad as I thought it would be. Right? And so some of the people have criticized this, and this actually fits with the Catholic moral teachings about this too, which also want to talk about the importance of caregiving and the importance of respect for the disabled and, lots of other things that are connected in here. But there's another side of this that says we actually learn a lot about ourselves and our community when we suffer and when we are diseased and disabled. Those are opportunities for building virtues. Do you hear that word virtue comes in here, right? For building virtues and caregiving and so on. Some of this, one of the criticisms is that it's sort of the presumption of upright middle-aged people that we will say, well, we'd never want this or that to happen to us without actually thinking about what it is actually like to be infirm and disabled and so on. Very interesting question whether we could predict our own interests, I think that literature is actually right about that. Because when you're 18, you can't predict what you want in middle age, And when you're in middle age, you can't predict what you'd want in old age. Our interests change, and our conception of ourselves change, and our conception of our community changes, right?
One other issue on this that I've worked with dying patients is their family wants something else. The family, it's their needs. Keep the oxygen on, keep the feeding. No matter what words you use, they cannot really have a narrow view based on their own needs.
Yeah, so now another interesting moral problem. Who matters, right? From a utilitarian standpoint, we're going to weigh up everyone's interests, right, and sort of figure out the happiness quotient there, right? Which would include family members, caregivers, and so on, because caregivers get invested in the process. Or maybe the only person that matters is the person who's dying, right? Or that maybe there's some equation where we balance the interests so that the person who's dying interests are kind of connected by some kind of algorithm to everyone else. Very interesting and complicated problem. And what you're sharing is, I've heard this from folks lots of times, that we the living have interests and needs vis-a-vis those who are dying, right? And sometimes those interests matter too, or maybe they don't. It's an interesting question. And then this connects then finally to physician-assisted suicide, which is quite different from the other ones in the sense that in this case, because it's suicide, you took it yourself, right? And some of the issues with the legislation on this are even trying to say, well, it shouldn't actually even be called suicide because there's a legal and insurance problem with suicide. And this is a somewhat different case. And so some people are even worried about using the word suicide with regard to this. But clearly, if it's self-killing, it's suicide of a sort. And as you know, this is becoming more and more acceptable across our country. There's a bunch of other issues that we'd want to think through if we're going to spend a semester talking about this, including this fascinating question of what is death. And you guys, some of you took that class with me where we talked about death and dying in the afterlife. And there's interesting, complicated questions. And the example, I think I have her on the next screen. The example we talked about last time was this young girl from Oakland, I believe, Jahai McMath. And she had a trauma during surgery, and the doctors said that she was brain dead. She's still alive, and she had her 15th birthday a few days ago. She's moved from California to the East Coast somewhere. And there's an interesting litigation going on with this which involves an interesting question about whether or not she's legally dead, and whether or not she's legally dead is connected to what kind of rights her parents have in court with regard to her. Because, I mean, can a legally dead person actually connect somehow into a court case? Does it matter that she's sort of alive but not alive, and so on? And so, I mean, lots of interesting questions come out here. And I've just kind of been keeping my eye on this because it's, you know, happened over in the Bay Area. And she's still alive, or not, depending on how what you think about this. There's a death certificate for her that was issued by Alameda County because they declared her legally dead, but she's still on life support. So is she alive or dead? Yeah, I'm sorry I interrupted you. We have another question over here.
Who's paying the bills?
I think there's been sort of community support, especially from organizations that are worried about suicide, end of life, physician assisted suicide. I think sort of the pro-life community has.
So she's legally dead and there is a death certificate, so the insurance isn't going to pay.
Yeah. I mean, you hear how complicated this gets? Is she alive or dead? And this question of who's paying the bills, that's connected to a utilitarian concern, right? About how much end of life care costs families, communities, societies, right? This is also connected to medical technology issues about how much of our death and dying happen in intense hospital circumstances and the bills go up. And you had a thought, yes.
I know a family, I don't know them very closely, but the young man is brain dead now, 25 years. The mother doesn't want to end. I think some kind of hydration or something. I don't think he's breathing though, but there's brain
so
dead.
She, in case you didn't hear, she says there's a case, a local case, where someone's alive for 25 years on life support.
I don't know how what kind of life support.
Yeah.
But that's cruel. The mother visits him every day, I heard.
Now, so interesting. Notice the language she just used was virtue language. Just trying to get those moral frameworks in. She said that's cruel to keep someone alive for that long. Someone else may say that's loving and caring. And here's the dispute, right? Is what the family's doing with Jahai, is it cruel? Or is that what families should do for their children? That's an interesting question. Notice also one thing about this is to make judgments about this, we'd have to imagine ourselves into the circumstances, you know? And this is the difficulty of moral judgment, is imagine that this happens, and then as time goes on, you know, what already happened connects to what you're going to do next, and stories evolve in this way. I mean, in this case, this family is now a test case for some people, right? So, there are societal and cultural pressures now on this family's decision. The same was true with Terry Schiavo, right? I mean, she became this cause celeb across the country. And so then you wonder, how can you make a judgment about what's happening in your family when the rest of the world is peering in, and how complicated that gets. Let's move on.
Is that human or machine? Is she human or machine? Because she's not self-sustaining.
Yeah.
And anything can be kept alive with machinery, so she's a machine. She's not a human.
Is she a human or a machine? That's an interesting question. Take that one home and talk it over dinner with your family members. And by the way, have those conversations with your family members about your own future. In my view, the more conversations we have about this, the better it will be for everyone. And I think sometimes when families show up from out of town and they never were in on the conversation, they didn't know, right? And so it's important to get all that out in the open. Yeah.
Really, we haven't dealt with this except for the last, 50 years?
Yeah.
To keep somebody alive? I mean, we let them die.
Yeah. In a sense, I hear what you're saying. This is a new ethical challenge for us. And by the way, for us means for all of us, because as Americans, they don't have this problem in, you know, like Nigeria or some places where they don't have this elaborate medical system that we have. But it's sort of a unique problem of affluent countries, you know, that we are privileged to make these choices about our death and dying, but it raises all kinds of complications because we've never had to deal with it before. We don't have good models. It's complicated. So just quickly on the moral theories, because I want to move on to the next topics. If there were a natural law, like a right to life, there's a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, a right to life, does that mean that no assistance in death should happen? Because there's a right to life, but then there's a right to liberty, which implies that one should be free to choose for oneself. Complicated, okay? Just picking a natural law or a human rights framework actually doesn't tell us the answer here, okay? Same is true with picking a duty standpoint, again, like say within a family, right? Maybe there's a duty to provide care and to sustain life in all costs, right? Or maybe there's a duty to help people die when the time comes. What is the duty there? Interesting set of duties, also a question, I don't have it up here, but a question for caregivers. And so some of the medical folks have been nervous to talk about this stuff, to help people die, because duties for caregivers and medical personnel are about sustaining life, not about bringing about death. Or maybe the duty for a caregiver is to respect the patient's wishes and provide for their well-being, even if their well-being might include death. Interesting set of conversations there. Happiness, we already talked about the complications here, whose happiness matters and how do we weigh it out? Very complicated. And then this last question about, there's Terry Schiavo, about autonomy and consent. Do we even have it? Autonomy, I mean. Is there such a thing? We think we know what that means. You tell me what my options are and I will choose. But the system is always rigged by the circumstances in a way, right? So is there ever full rational autonomy? Are there social pressures, cultural pressures that factor in here? How much does autonomy actually matter? Maybe happiness is more important than autonomy, or maybe autonomy is an essential component of happiness. How does that all play itself out? And then what do we do in circumstances where we don't know what people's wishes would be, or there are disputes about what's in their best interest? Very complicated. And we're in, as a couple of you pointed out, we're in the middle of a lot of this stuff, and it's going to be an ongoing conversation here in the United States. Last bit about this. We talked about this in the book, so I just thought I'd bring in this issue, which is that folks in disabilities rights community are worried about all of these conversations about end of life because there's a judgment made in these conversations about what counts as a quality life. And we think we know what we mean when we say a quality life, but usually a quality life involves, you know, standing upright with your mental faculties and so on. And the worry is that those judgments about quality of life are implicit negative judgments towards people with certain kinds of disabilities. So in the book, we talk about Peter Singer, who we'll talk about in a few minutes more. Peter Singer, very famous ethicist at Princeton University, notorious ethicist at Princeton University, because he argues that in some cases, it is in the best interest of, like, disabled infants, for example, to kill them. And he, I think, doesn't even shy away from the active side. I mean, it would be less cruel to actively kill them. So he said this, is a quote from his book on practical ethics, killing a disabled infant is not morally equivalent to killing a person. Very often, it is not wrong at all. Killing a disabled infant is not wrong at all. Yes. So I mean, I guess the circumstances, if a child is born with severe disabilities, in Singer's, I mean, the circumstances matter, which disabilities, right? But in some circumstances, Singer says, it would not be wrong to kill the infant. Okay.
There was an article in the paper today about the baby that was born and would never be able to do anything and had been given, I don't know how many millions of dollars to sustain the baby.
Okay, is this...
Couldn't think, couldn't see, couldn't walk, couldn't do anything.
So the example she says up here somewhere in the news today was a child born with severe disabilities and at least from the description, sort of lack of hope and no quality of life.
A newborn.
And then you said lots and lots of money to sustain the life of that newborn. Yeah. Singer would say the right thing to do, the humane thing to do, is to kill the child. Okay. He got invited to go to Germany to give a talk, and they disinvited him. And they said, wait a minute, Professor Singer is not permitted to give that talk in Germany because Germany has a bad history of killing off disabled people. Harriet McBride Johnson, I think I misspelled her last name here actually, but Harriet McBride Johnson was a disabilities activist. She is now deceased, but she debated Peter Singer very famously about 10 years ago. She went to Princeton, the New York Times covered this, and she basically, you know, sat across the stage from him and said, Professor Singer, do you mean that people like me don't deserve to live? And apparently it was quite an interesting conversation. So what she says, Singer's unexamined assumption that disabled people are inherently worse off, that we suffer, that we have lesser prospects of a happy life. Because of this all too common prejudice and his rare courage in taking it to his logical conclusion, catastrophe looms. Her worry is this, that if Singer is taken seriously, we will kill more and more disabled babies, in which case there will be fewer disabled people, in which case disability will be that much more disabling because there are fewer of them to worry about, right? A kind of eugenic, I mean, she's worried about kind of eugenics.
How do you determine what's the disability that draws the line?
Yeah. Again, so now she asks, well, which disability are we talking about, right? And so the facts matter. Singer, I don't think, is talking about, like, say, Down syndrome or something. He's talking about this severe case where you said someone is, like, complete lack of quality of life. The circumstances matter, right? Those who are worried about a slippery slope, though, will say, you know, we start with certain types of disabilities and then we broaden it, and that is obviously wrong, especially from the disabilities rights standpoint. Yes?
Well, that's what disturbs me about his statement. It's just disabled. There's no adverb in there. Like, so it's just disabled.
Yeah.
And who makes that determination?
Lovely question, right? Who gets to decide, similar to what you're saying, who gets to draw the line here? And some will say there should be no line drawn whatsoever. Right? It's not our business to play God and to draw the line in this case. Others will say, well, you know, we're going to consult doctors and we're going to consult ethicists. Should we consult insurance companies?
Conflict of interest.
You hear the worry now. I mean, think about it. You said this child costs, millions to sustain the life of this child. Could it be in the interest of insurance companies for this kind of, you know, euthanasia for infants to go forward? You hear how complicated that gets. Okay, let's move on to the next topic. Is that okay with you all if we move on? Yeah. Take that one to dinner table tonight, you know, euthanasia for infants with severe disabilities. Great topic. You'll, yeah. The lasagna will be thrown against the wall at some point. So you saw this in the news. This is the Christmas tree in Clovis that they cut down. It's so sad, the Christmas tree. Euthanasia for Christmas trees. Or cut it out. It's just a tree. It doesn't matter, right? Well, that's, I think they're going to replace that with something. That's just a tree. But you know what they did all summer to defend the sequoia trees against the fire, right? From a certain standpoint, what the heck? You know, millions and millions of dollars spent to defend sequoia trees that suffer fire naturally, that seems to be, from a certain standpoint, a huge waste of resources. Or the sequoia are that important and have that much symbolic and intrinsic value that we should take extreme measures and pay a lot of money in order to defend them. Interesting question when you start thinking about this, right? Presumably you've seen the sequoia. They're cool and awesome, and we sort of think they have a kind of majesty and, you know, sacredness that we should work to defend them. But you know, 150 years ago, they cut them down, right? This view that somehow these have value, that's a new view in the world. There were a few people, Galen Rowell and John Muir and some of these guys sort of saw it and got the value of the trees, but most people didn't at that time. Interesting question. How do we appraise the value of a tree or a waterfall or a species? That's one of the questions of environmental ethics. So we'll return to that question of the intrinsic value of nature in a minute. It's a very complicated question. One view, the anthropocentric view, says really this stuff is only valuable for us, anthropos, human beings. Anthropocentric means it is human-centered. This is a value for us. Why do we defend sequoia trees? We like them, right? They don't have any value in themselves, it's for us. We like to go and sit under them. We may actually like to cut them down and turn them into paper or whatever it is that you do with a sequoia tree, right? But it's a value for us. A different view, the non-anthropocentric view, says that these things have value in themselves apart from our interest in them, and that our obligation is to respect their intrinsic value. Okay? Those two views are worlds apart, and they conflict. So some ecologists and environmentalists want to talk about the intrinsic value of natural things. Others will say it's too mystical, it's too mysterious, and we should focus on human-oriented value. Okay, we'll return to that. It's a deep, deep question, very interesting one. To get towards that, there is lots of obvious issues from the anthropocentric perspective. So environmental issues matter, maybe not because of anything about the environment, but because of us, right? If you live in this valley, you know the problem of air pollution and asthma and decreased happiness, lung problems, and so on. Here was some recent data. In the nation, the metropolitan areas that rank worst for air pollution. For ozone pollution, here's Fresno, number 4 in the nation for ozone. Particulate pollution, number 1, Fresno, Madeira. Annual particulate pollution, so this is the total cumulative, Fresno, Madeira, number 1. And then I'm sure you've seen these kind of maps before that basically shows that it sucks to live here. You can't even see the mountains most days in the summer. This comes from this website is, well, what they did is they reproduced a report from the American Lung Association. I can't remember what this stands for, but if you're interested in following up on the data, you can go look there. Does this matter because the sequoia trees will die? Does air pollution, air pollution affects everything, right? Does air pollution matter because of the intrinsic value of the bear? Do bears get asthma? I don't know. But presumably, if this stuff affects us, it also affects other living things, right? Does it matter because of those other living things that it affects, or does it matter because of us? Most people probably think what really matters is us, right? These environmental issues, air pollution, climate change, and the rest, those matter because of their impact on us. So that's the anthropocentric approach, which says that ultimately, at the end of the day, bears, nice. We're not worried about bear asthma. We're worried about asthma in our children because children, human beings, have value. Any value the natural world has, it's derivative of our value that we have, right? That's the anthropocentric question. Notice, though, with the anthropocentric question, what we're going to end up doing is a lot of cost-benefit exchanges. Because at the end of the day, even the sequoia tree, if it has no value in itself, we may decide to chop it down and use it for a human benefit somehow, right? On this view, by the way, there's no such, on a real deep kind of understanding of anthropocentrism, there's no claim about sort of the natural cleanliness of the air in the Central Valley. What would that be? Instead, it's about maximizing human interests in the environment. Right? So if you thought this about pollution, some pollution is obviously necessary to live the lifestyles we live. We like to drive cars, we like to eat food, right? We like to fly on airplanes, whatever it is, the pollution that is produced that's here in the valley, it's in our interest to produce that pollution because we benefit from all the industrial activities that go into it, right? From the anthropocentric standpoint, if we're worried about environmental issues, the question is how do we balance our interests in industrialization versus our interests in clean air, okay? And so on and so forth with all kinds of issues, from preserving forests to dealing with fisheries to worrying about watersheds and water quality and so on. From a pure anthropocentric view, what really matters is balancing our human interests, and one of our interests includes industrial activity, which has these negative effects on the environment. This, you're not surprised to hear this. Now, some people will claim that that is just so shallow. This has been described as shallow ecology by the deep ecologists. So we'll get to the deep ecologists in a second. But this, from a certain standpoint, this looks like exactly part of the problem, right? That we keep talking about maximizing our own interests and our own benefits, and in fact, we don't actually fix the environmental problems. Instead, we just optimize pollution. That can't be the solution, says the non-anthropocentrists. We'll get to the non-anthropocentric view in 1 second. So one of the concerns from an anthropocentric standpoint is what is called environmental justice. You may have heard this phrase before. It's often used, and there are organizations focused on environmental justice concerns. The word justice in environmental justice almost always refers to justice for human beings. It's anthropocentric. And one of the issues is that some people do okay, some human beings do okay within environmental crises or problems, but other people suffer tremendously from environmental impacts and damage. So you may know that this tracks poverty, right? Poor people suffer more from environmental degradation. There are these sort of pollution concentrations that are in poor neighborhoods, right? Poor people suffer more from environmental impacts. One of the big examples that's discussed in environmental justice is this explosion at the Union Carbide plant in Bhopal, India, which killed 3,000 people within the first day and a final death toll of somewhere between 15 and 22,000 people. The gas bloom spilled over the city and basically, you know, wiped people out. That's an environmental issue, right? When industrialization produces poisonous outflows that kills people, it's a human issue, it's an anthropocentric issue, it's a justice issue, because isn't it convenient that this happened to be in India, where the environmental regulations were looser and the liability laws were different? And my understanding of this, we talk a little bit about this in the book, but my understanding of this case is that most of the wrongdoers never had to really pay much in terms of restitution, and no criminal punishment came along with it. That's a justice issue. Do you hear that that's anthropocentric? It's about humans and how humans operate within environmental contexts. All right, understand the anthropocentric view. The ecocentric view says, you know, the problem with you anthropocentrists is that you keep talking about humans and you're not talking about bears and trees and endangered species and the rest of it, and ecosystems and watersheds and all the rest of it. But it's puzzling. You know what I mean by ecosystem, right? So the integrated web of animals and plants and soil that kind of sustains itself through mutual exchanges of energy, and however you want to describe that, right? Puzzling, what's the value of an ecosystem? Historically, they come and go, by the way, right? Even, what is the value of a species? Are you worried about endangered species?
People come and go too, though.
We do. We haven't been around for all that long. The dinosaurs were around longer than we were. They died off. I mean, what is the value of an endangered species? It's a puzzling question, actually, right? We want to say a species has value in itself. Some people want to say that. The anthropocentrist will say it has value for us, either because we like them, whatever they are. Name your favorite endangered species. The gray wolf or something in North America, actually making a big comeback. The wolves are making a big comeback. But by the way, with the comeback of the wolf, anthropocentric, cool, now we can go see wolves in Yellowstone or whatever. It's in our interest. A little bit more complicated anthropocentric argument will say that actually we humans benefit from biodiversity. Have you heard this phrase before, biodiversity? Right? We benefit when the ecosystem is healthy, because after all, we depend upon the ecosystem, especially the global ecosystem, right? That's still an anthropocentric argument. And the deep ecologists, the ecocentrists, will say it just doesn't go deep enough because it's still about human interests, not about whatever value the environment itself has. Back to the tree. You know, does the tree have value in itself? It's puzzling. Most of the anthropocentrists will say, you know, the problem is there's no way to get outside of the human framework. When we're talking about ethics, we're talking about humans. We're not talking about things out there in the world. So anyone heard of this guy, Aldo Leopold? He's an important figure in this discussion. Italian?
Is he Italian?
He's from Wisconsin. I don't know what his... I don't know what his way background heritage is. It sounds, yeah. Hey, Aldo Leopold. Yeah, it's like an Italian. He's one of the naturalists after John Muir, our local hero. Aldo Leopold is sort of the next generation. And Leopold talked about the land ethic. And his point about this is that we all benefit when the land, understood as ecosystems and soil systems, when the land is healthy. So this claim, a thing is right, an action is right, when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It's wrong when it tends to do otherwise. Okay? Notice this claim about integrity. That sort of puts the value out there in the world, right? The system itself is integrated, and we do the right thing environmentally when we help the system to sustain itself. Okay? Stability, right? It sustains itself over time. And then in terms of the beauty of it, interesting question, is the beauty of a tree or a meadow, is it there by itself? Is it just beautiful? Or is it only beautiful when we show up to see it?
No. It's like a tree in the forest.
Does the bee know that the flower is beautiful? No, I don't think so. Does the bee, okay. The bee can smell the flower. Is excited by the flowers. I don't know, it's an interesting question. Okay. Leopold, though, he gets this idea going about the land ethic, which is on the side of the ecocentric view. That what matters is something in the system itself, whether or not we're involved in it. And what we ought to do with regard to natural systems is try to allow them to be their own thing and not interfere. And when we interfere and destroy those systems, then we've done something wrong. We've violated, in a sense, the spirit of the land or the integrity of the land. Notice the anthropocentrists will say, oh, cut it out. You know, we need to use the land. We got to grow some crops there and so on. And if that means we're going to have to destroy the beauty and the integrity of the soil system or whatever, sorry, we're going to have to plant some crops because we got to feed human beings. Okay, that's the anthropocentric view.
What about the results that we have come through Chinese medicines? So many of the medicines today are related to all of these plants and flowers. Maybe the DNA of that tree, it's very, very old. Maybe there's something there we could get.
So she suggests, you know, there's stuff to be derived from nature that's powerful and valuable. Chinese medicine, in case you didn't hear, she says, you know, you discover uses, or not just Chinese, but indigenous cures, right? You discover that certain herbs and whatever have medicinal properties. Still anthropocentric. You get it? Well, I mean, one of these arguments says, well, we should just preserve the rainforest because we could discover cures for cancer in the rainforest, but it's about human cancers that will be cured.
But you're looking for a reason that is why we should value them.
Yes. So one argument, again, that you can argue with people from an anthropocentric standpoint and say we should preserve these natural systems, preserve the biotic community, because it's a benefit for us, right? The deep ecologists will say, stop talking about us. We're just part of the whole. We can't only worry about our own interests. And so the conversation goes back and forth. There's John Muir. I forgot about John Muir. He's cool. I like John Muir. Muir, I think, had a ecocentric, a non-anthropocentric interest in nature. When he talks about sort of God being there in Yosemite Valley, you know, I think he means God is in Yosemite Valley whether or not I am in Yosemite Valley. It's something that has value in itself. I think that's John Muir's language. He's influenced, as you probably know, by American transcendentalists, Ralph Waldo Emerson and others, who wanted to talk about sort of spirit and energy and value in the world, apart from any interest we have in it. So here's the deep ecology view. And notice this graphic that tries to represent this, right? This is the anthropocentric model. The humans are on the top of the biotic pyramid, and we benefit from healthy interactions all the way through the structure, right? It's anthropocentric, which says that we want to make sure we preserve the pyramid so that we can preserve ourselves. That's anthropocentric. The non-anthropocentric view says, well, we got to take ourselves off the top. We have to integrate ourselves into the world somehow and understand that we're just one part of a much larger whole. And what's good or beneficial for the whole is what's good, not just what's good or beneficial for us, okay? So deep ecologists have a very radical critique of contemporary culture. And some of them are actually on the verge of like anti-civilizational activity. There's something from the deep ecology standpoint, something deeply dysfunctional in the way we live our lives.
Yeah.
Yeah, she says yeah. But the anthropocentrist will say, what are you going to do about it? It's us living our lives, right? One hint on this. Some of the deep ecologists want to say that we need to go back to a pre-civilizational standpoint when there were 500 million humans on Earth. One of the problems is, you agree with that one too?
Yeah,
okay. One of the problems is that there are just too many of us, and we have to dominate the rest of nature in order to support the human population. The anthropocentrist will say that's the way it goes, right? Unless you want to talk about radical population culling, cull the human herd somehow. Some of the deep ecologists point in this misanthropic direction, which says that human beings are like a blight or a cancer on the earth. There's too many of us, and we're growing out of control, and some kind of radical population measures are needed. Notice, I mean, think about this. To get away from human domination of the entire globe, including the oceans, right, because we're overfishing the oceans and so on, we've changed the climate. Some people call this the Anthropocene. Have you heard this word, Anthropocene?
Anthropocene.
Yeah, which means that this is now, we're in a new era, a new geological era. This is the era of human-generated global shifts. That's anthropocentric. And some of the deep ecologists will say, we got to get back to this, where there is no longer human domination of nature, but we are integrated into nature. How are we going to do that, though?
War.
She said war. I saw one hand over here, and then I see your hand. Yes.
I have to ask, why is the woman on the second tier?
That's a great question.
He would not be on top if it wasn't for a mother.
I love that. It's a very important question. Notice here they're equal, or at least they're, you know, same size. There's another view closely related to deep ecology called ecofeminism, which says that one of the problems connected to the anthropocentric hierarchy is that it's also male-centric hierarchy. Male domination is part of the problem. And that view would continue to say that, for example, rampant capitalist consumerist growth serves the interests of dominant males and is bad for women. And the cure is to make not only human beings equal to other species, but to create equality between the genders. Do you hear this? You hear how deep that is? It's deep, you know? Radical critique, the ecofeminist view, radical critique of dominant structures. Let me add one wrinkle in. I saw your hand. I'll get to you in one second. One wrinkle about this, which is that this story that puts human beings at the top, that puts men at the top, this story is connected with hierarchical religious traditions, which say that, you know, first God created all this junk, and then, as the ultimate, God created man, and by the way, woman was derived later from the rib, right? The deep ecologists want to criticize those Western dominating male-oriented structures. It's a great point. Thank you for catching that in the picture. You had a question over here, yes?
Yeah, I question if we were ever there on the right.
Yeah.
I think it's a myth that we were ever there.
How far back do we have to go?
Yeah. Years.
Yeah. At least a couple hundred? Couple tens of thousands, probably. Right? There's a lovely phone going over there. This is the anti-civilizational conversation in the deep ecologist side. It has to go at least back before the domestication of animals. This word domestication is a bad word from the deep ecologist standpoint. How far back does that go? I think dogs were domesticated like 20,000 years ago or something like that. So maybe we've got to roll it back that far. Notice the story about this is this kind of hierarchy with men at the top, which gives us environmental crises. This hierarchy depends on us subordinating all of these other creatures. That's the domestication problem, right? Maybe farther back than just the domestication of animals. Maybe it's the domestication of plants and soils, too. So that's, I mean, how far back are we going to go? The anthropocentrists, the contemporary environmentalists like Al Gore, just to cite one that you may know about, will just say, that's nutty. You know, we're not going to go back. It'd be impossible to go back. It's misanthropic to even think we could go back, because we'd have to kill off lots of people. It's not going to happen, nor should it happen. Which means, back to the anthropocentric endeavor, we're going to try to find a way to balance human interests and optimize things through cost-benefit analysis. So Al Gore or whoever shows up and says this, and then the deep ecologists say, you're just saying the same story one more time again, right? You're not curing the problem. You're just dealing with the symptoms of the problem. Huge, interesting dispute. Yes?
The cost-benefit analysis always leaves off what time frame?
Yeah.
If you look at cost-benefit analysis over a quarter or a year, is way different from cost-benefit analysis over 10 and 100 and 1,000 years.
Yeah.
The impact of doing this.
Yeah. So in case you didn't hear, he's saying cost-benefit over which time frame, right? And also over which geographic expanse, too, by the way, right? We can probably, focus in on 1 year, 5 year, 10 year plan, but there is this question, like, how long is this sustainable, this mode of civilization, right? As population grows and as we continue to subordinate and destroy some of the species that support life on this planet and feed the soils and so on, how long can it go on and what time frames do we have to consider? And we know, as someone pointed out over here, we haven't been around that long, you know? We would just like it to be at least a few generations longer. yes?
Well, it just makes you think about fracking and what the hell that's doing to the entire...
Well, fracking's an interesting question, yeah. So, I mean, here's the thing. We like oil. You drove here. I drove here. We like it, you know? At what expense to the environment and to sustainable futures for groundwater and so on, at what expense do we like that oil? You know, that's the cost-benefit analysis, which says, well, we're going to have to find ways to maximize this. And we'll leave it to the technocrats and the scientists to sort of work it out, how we're going to balance all these human interests. And the deep ecologists stand on the side and say, same shit another day. You know, first you drilled, now you're frack. You know, what are you going to do next? Put nuclear reactors in every car? I mean, the deep ecologists have a very deep critique of all of these systems, right? And so it goes. I mean, hopefully you hear, I'm a bit sympathetic to this view. And yet the big worry is it can quickly become misanthropic, right? This stuff about population growth and so on. I mean, guess what, by the way, in terms of population growth? What that probably means is rich people will do okay and we'll let the poor people die. I mean, in terms of practicality, if someone's talking about population growth. Well, she says, who consumes more resources, right? Clearly, the ecological footprint of someone like ourselves is much larger than the ecological footprint of poor people in other parts of the world. We consume much more resources. But guess who's going to win in the struggle for survival? We are, because we have political and economic and industrial power. which leads us to climate change in 10 minutes. Should I just tell you the bad news on this one? Or
I think we all know the bad news.
Well, So here's the anthropocentric approach. We'll say, look, we need growth, we need resource, we need to use resources and so on. We've just got to find a way to optimize it, right? We need to do cost-benefit analysis, both in short-term and longer mid-term. We've got to find a way to negotiate this issue. The deep ecologists will say, the problem is you keep singing the same song and the problem isn't getting fixed, right? And if you've looked at any of the kind of international conventions focused on climate change agreements, it seems like they're not making sufficient progress, if at all, any progress on this. And the concentrations of CO2 in the atmosphere continue to climb. And growth is happening. It's not going back, especially as the developing world becomes developed, right? So China and India and all of these other huge populations want to live like us, right? To do that, they need to burn fossil fuels, okay? That's part of the problem. Let me just skip to this guy's book. I saw him speak about a year ago at a conference. Stephen Gardner, he's in Seattle, I think the University of Washington. And he calls the climate change problem a perfect moral storm. The problem is we're all anthropocentric. We can't get that ecocentric perspective. It's just not going to happen, right? Not only are we anthropocentric, we're egocentric. We're nationalistic-centric, right? The world consists of competition for resources, right? It's not going to get any better with that frame. And so Gardner is not hopeful. He was at the conference. I raised my hand. I said, are you hopeful? And he said, looked me right in the eye, and he said, my job as a philosopher is not to provide hope to people. And he's kind of right. I mean, you can't lie, right? I mean, it's just like at the end of life issue. She left, but our hospice nurse left. But with end of life, I mean, you have to be truthful, you know? And the truth is we got a complicated political and moral problem that we're not anywhere near solving, I don't think. So we got this problem of future generations. Nobody cares about future generations, let's be honest. We kind of talk about it, but if we really meant it, we would do things probably quite differently, okay? Gardner points out it's just impossible, this is the time scale thing, it's just impossible to plan activities today in light of their impacts on people 70, 100 years from now. We're not built, our brains don't work that way, our logic doesn't work that way, okay? Nor are we prepared to think about people in other parts of the world who are going to suffer more as this crisis hits. We're not prepared for that morally. We don't think that way. We're egocentric, nation-centric, regionally focused, right? We're self-interested. And then these two problems, moral philosophers talk about these problems. The one, the tragedy of the commons, basically holds that when there are common areas, they will always be abused by self-interested agents, mm-hmm. Right? So if no one owns the river, then everyone will dump their junk in the river. There's no sense of responsibility towards shared things. And guess what the largest shared resource on Earth is? The atmosphere, right? We can dump our pollution there all we want. Nobody owns it, right? It's in self-interested agents with regard to the global sink, right, where we dump all our stuff. There's no sense of restraint there. Cap and trade may be some kind of attempt to fix that, you know, but notice, that's a nice anthropocentric approach, the cap and trade issue. So, you know, and this shows up in different areas, I mean, also with fisheries and so on, right? Nobody owns the fisheries, and so guess what? They're overfished, right? That's how it works, because each self-interested agent is trying to get as much as they can before the other guy does, okay? And then this prisoner's dilemma problem, which is basically a problem of self-interest, which is sort of like this, is when we're engaged in a competitive struggle and we don't trust each other, each one of us is going to try to outdo the other guy before he betrays or destroys me, right? It's a competitive, male-dominant view, which says we're just going to struggle ourselves until we both end up till we all end up with suboptimal outcomes. Okay, Gardner is not happy about this. I don't know what the solution is either. So let me get to Hillel Elver. Here she is. So just to sort of tell you what she said yesterday and how she connected this to food issues. So she was here on campus yesterday speaking about food security and climate change. She gave a lot of
I wanted to know, who is she and where is she from?
Good question. She is the UN Special Rapporteur on food security issues. So she is a person empowered by the United Nations to go around the world and understand food issues and how food is being distributed. She also teaches at UC Santa Barbara. So we were able to get her to drive over and then get her expertise on this. She pointed out that as climate impacts become worse, food security issues are also going to become worse because, as we're experiencing here in the Central Valley, water supplies dwindle, groundwater gets pumped, right? As the temperature goes up, it's harder to grow the crops and so on. And then she added this very interesting, I thought, point is that there's a positive feedback loop, or negative, depending on how you evaluate this. But there's a feedback loop, right, which is that as the climate increases and development increases and poverty increases, that the solution is more development, more groundwater pumping, bigger agriculture, right, which just exacerbates the problem. And then she pointed out some facts and figures about how agriculture actually contributes to climate change. You may have heard about the methane from the cows, right? Including the use of fossil fuels to produce and distribute food. Meanwhile, of course, there are hungry people in other parts of the world, in other parts of town, right? There are hungry people, and the solution seems to be to make more food, which then has more impacts on the climate and makes it harder to grow more food in the long run. Kind of a bleak assessment. I don't know if a few of you were there. It didn't sound like a happy outcome to me. Let's see. So from her report, let me just read a couple of these to you. She says, climate change, sustainable resource management, and food security are now widely considered independent and among the most urgent global policy challenges. Climate change is already having significant detrimental impacts on approximately 1 billion of the world's poor. And the point, again, is it affects poor people more than others. This is environmental justice, right? The question of who benefits and who's impacted. It's an anthropocentric concern for human beings. By the way, this whole report is anthropocentric. No one's even saying, like, the impact of climate and agriculture on forests, on soils, on fisheries, on endangered species. Those would be ecocentric concerns. The anthropocentric concerns are severe enough. Then you start thinking about bears and sequoia trees. We'll layer that in. She continues, individuals and communities living in vulnerable situations and at risk of discrimination due to geography, poverty, gender, age, indigenous or minority status, and disability are often disproportionately affected. This is the justice issue again. Women, children, the disabled, poor people will be more adversely affected by this stuff than we affluent males will be at the top of the hierarchy.
You mentioned war, too.
And, okay, we want to bring war in on this. Resource wars, right, about water, about land, about access to the seas, environmental refugees, right? I mean, she pointed out that some of the stuff that's happening in Syria, people leaving Syria, yes, there is war there, but if the war is connected to resource wars and those people are fleeing looking for a decent standard of living. By the way, she also pointed out that the climate change impacts will be severe in the Middle East, where it's becoming hotter quicker, and they don't have a sustainable agricultural infrastructure there. They import a lot of their food products, and it's getting too hot for people to live there. Not enough water for the people who do live there. It doesn't look good. I'm not going to read all that to you, but can I take you to one happy ending hope? I lost it. Hold on, bear with me. We got 5 minutes, and I'll give you one hopeful
I was there last night.
Yeah.
And I was disappointed in her lecture because she only pointed out the negative.
Yes.
She gave nothing on the positive.
Yes.
So she didn't bring up, like, Broberg with the Green Revolution, which has changed especially India, which still has poverty. I mean, when I was a child, all the churches ran, we sent money to India because it was always starving. Now India does produce enough grain for export at certain times. I mean, there's all sorts of things with it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, she gave you no hope. And I do think that the people manage, and we are changing. We are becoming more educated, especially producing of food. We haven't, I mean, the population and all the other things, the politics. But she didn't do that. And I was just very disappointed that she didn't.
She left you with a sense of hopelessness. But yes. By the way, this is a significant moral problem. Because without hope, there's no reason for moral action. Right? I mean, you have to believe that your efforts will make a difference. Otherwise, you just go back into self-interest, right? So I'm just going to maximize what's good for me, because if we're all doomed, I'm going to get mine before the whole thing sinks, right? I call this in some other work the moral imperative of hope, that there's a moral requirement to find hope. Without it, we really are doomed, right? Because there's then no reason for anyone to take any of this seriously. I agree with you. She needed some kind of hopeful message at the end. Remember I said Stephen Gardner, that guy, he said, it's not my job to give you hope. My view is a little different. I think that the moral philosopher has to find ways to offer hope. Otherwise, there will be no moral improvement whatsoever. So, it reverts to self-interest. Let me direct your attention to Vandana Shiva, who was mentioned at the talk last night. She's another activist who's been working on food security issues and so on. Shiva's hopeful projects is to find a way to empower all those people who Elver pointed out were left out. To empower women, to empower indigenous people, to empower the poor, right? To celebrate local cultures, and how about to empower the ecosystem too, right? That's a bit of that ecocentric view. I mean, the solution, if there is to be a solution, has to be with everyone who suffers. So back to environmental justice claim, right? If there's an injustice, I mean, it can be a top-down solution, like we're going to fix it for everyone else, but that's still part of the problem, right? So it's to find a way to empower everyone who's on the losing end of the justice imbalance. Shiva, radical critique of agriculture and development, how we do it. I mean, almost so radical that you sort of want to think it's just kind of a pipe dream. But you have to have those dreamers too. You know, somebody has to point out we could live differently, we could grow our food differently, we could have a different distribution of wealth and income and status and so on. We could, if we choose to do so, you know. And then that takes political, moral, cultural effort. It's an interesting question about whether we're willing to do that. A couple of people had their hands. We have a couple minutes here. You had your hand up, and I see you back there. Yeah. Let me get the guy in the front, and then back to you. Yeah.
Well, Albert's last slide mentioned Gleisman's agroecology book, and she didn't go into the details of it, but that is a sustainable approach to farming, which was a very positive and constructive thing. The only problem is it's not scalable to industrial agriculture.
Yeah.
It does provide increased yield to what industrial agriculture provides.
So he's pointing out there, and she actually mentions that in the UN report if you dig in there, that there is at least one alternative called agroecology, which is a different approach to growing food. And he points out the difficulty is how are we going to build that out while we have industrial agriculture sort of occupying the space of food production. But there are plausible systems systematic solutions that could provide alternatives. Yeah?
My take on her talk was that she was repeating what she was doing in the United Nations and trying to get them to address those problems in each of their different countries. And so there is hope that if they listen to
Not very nice point. Maybe we can conclude with this thought, because I'm right there with you. The one hopeful thing is that people are talking about this and writing books about it and delivering lectures to the United Nations, and people are attending to these things. Let me just connect that quickly back to the euthanasia, suicide, and all the rest of the stuff we talked about. In a sense, we're much better now because we can have these kind of conversations that 50, 100 years ago, none of this stuff was, I mean, you couldn't sit here and talk civilly about killing old people or whatever, I mean, however you want to put that. You couldn't have a civil conversation about environmental issues and critiques of global systems of agriculture. I mean, in a sense, right, the hope is like this, right, that we're here actually talking about this stuff. So next time we will talk about animals.